that because sitting around in no jungle mesquite, dumb as an eagle doing nothing. Superman never made anybody saving the world from Solomon Grundy. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him. Hey, Bob, Sue had a straight job. Smash any bank in the United States. He had the strength, but he would not. Folks said his family were all dead. Planet crumbled, but Superman, he forced himself to carry on. Get Krypton and keep going. Superman never made any money for saving the world from Solomon Grundy. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him. Tarzan is king of the jungle and lord over all the apes, but he could hardly string together four words. I, Tarzan, Jane. Sometimes when Sue was stopping crimes, I'll bet he was tempted to just quit and turn his back on men. Join Tarzan in the forest. But he stayed in the city, kept on changing clothes and dirty phone booths till his work was through. And nothing to do but go on. Superman never made any money saving the world from Solomon Grundy. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him.
That song by the Crash Test Dummies, the Superman song, was fairly popular in the day. Not a lot of people really get it. I suppose you had to live another generation for it to start to make sense. When that song came out in the 1990s, there wasn't the craze at that time that there is right now for superheroes. Now, I quite frankly love this superhero craze. I grew up on the comic books and was told that they had to outgrow them. And now as an adult, I get to go to all the movies and I get to see my favorites of Iron Man and Superman and, you know, Black Panther, all of them out there doing their thing. But I'm also aware of why we're looking for them. Same reason why on the screen you see an image of Jesus of Nazareth dressed up as a superhero. And his name emblazoned with an S logo like Superman. Because that's what we want. We're looking for it today. Because while our movie screens are filled with superheroes, Our news feeds and television screens are filled with the anti-heroes. All those populist leaders that people have raised up to become their own personal tyrants, capriciously changing the world. I was going to juxtaposition that super Jesus image with a photograph of Donald Trump, and my stomach couldn't take it. Because we see what people do when they acquire great power, great wealth, and great position. In the song you just heard, it talks about Superman never made any money doing his thing. He never made any money saving the world from Solomon Grundy. He never let anybody know who he was, and even though he overcame all the problems in his life of losing his home and his family, and he went out and gave himself to mankind in that sense of being Superman, but kept his identity quiet. And as Clark Kent, he could have come out and said, "I am Superman, give me great accolades." He didn't. Today's scripture, we have Jesus walking through the village or town of Caesarea Philippi with his disciples. Now, what you got to know about Caesarea Philippi is it was the God capital of the earth at the time. It's the birthplace of the god Pan. So many of the Greek and Roman gods had temples there. Walking through this place where all this god stuff is going on, of all the different gods of society, Jesus asks his disciples the question, "Who do people say I am?" And Eureka, in the midst of all the gods, they recognize God. And Simon Peter says, "We are the Christ, the Messiah." In other words, the one of God. And Jesus' first response is to do the Clark Kent thing and say, "Nah, don't tell a soul. Not a word. You keep that quiet." And what you actually hear in scripture is an actual outright conflict and argument between the disciples and their leader, their master, their teacher. It says, Simon Peter actually rebuked him, took him aside and got into an argument with him. And then Jesus in turn rebukes him and says, "Get behind me, Satan. What you're hearing is, you got to come out and tell everybody. We got to take control. We got to run the society. This is God in place. We've got to be out there and take it over. You've been chosen. We are electing you to be our leader." And there's the temptation that happens to everybody who actually comes close to even the imaginary powers of a superhero. They could do what they want, the way we want. We put people in that position in our world. And when Jesus says, "No, there's another way to live this world. You don't tell them how much power you have. You don't tell them who you are. You just do what God calls you to do. You just step out into the world and you make a change." And it's true that what we do in little ways has a magnificent and profound impact on our society. And you don't have to take control to change it. Control corrupts. Power corrupts. Christ knew that. He resisted the temptation of the Satan in the desert. He resisted the temptation of the pull of his disciples to use his power. And instead, we have a world that recognizes the power of Christ, not a society that labored under his dictatorship. That's a fact. And how do we know it changes the world? Sometimes when you stop and notice, you see how the power of little things changes the world. I was thinking as I came in here today that I'm really sorry that Mia's not with me today. She's usually with me, but she had a chance to spend an overnight with a friend last night, so she was at her friend's home. And the mother called up this morning and said, I know Sophia's working today, and I know you've got a full day. I'll just keep her with me today. And I'm a parent. I'm not crazy. I said yes. Sophia said yes. But when I saw Emma come in, I thought, oh my God, she's going to miss this. She would also be embarrassed by what I'm going to say, because this week passed, Sophia, me, and I had to do our annual pilgrimage to the Mexican consulate for their Mia's and Sophia's passport documents. We're walking down King Street in Toronto, and there's a beggar on the street. And Mia pulls away from me and runs up to the beggar. And I said, oh, you know, okay, now your five-year-old daughter has just run up to a homeless street beggar in Toronto, and, you know, people are looking at you, and you're sitting there thinking, is this safe and all the rest, but she's over, she bends down, gets in the guy's face, and says, are you okay? And she talks to him, and he talks back with her, he asks her how she is. And when I got up to her, I said, it's okay, Mia, you can come now. And I looked at the man and I said, I'm really sorry, I don't have any cash on me, I don't carry cash. He says, that's okay, she's given me all I need. And I said to her, why did you do that? She goes, well, he looked hurt, Daddy, and you told me that God's with everyone. And so, watch what you're saying. Sometimes it works out for the best. And that's how you change the world. You change the world by doing what Jesus did, telling his disciples, don't talk about it. Just know the power and use it. Superman didn't make any money. He had all the power in the world, but he saved people. Super Jesus has saved people by never being Super Jesus. It was the old question from the rock opera, Jesus Christ Superstar. If you had come today, you could have saved the whole nation. You know, and use your power. It was never about the power of God. It's about how we use the power of God. How we articulate it in the small ways in our world. How we greet people and open up our lives to people. And make a difference in what we do and where we do it. And that's what Jesus is trying to say to his disciples amidst all the gods of the earth. Amongst all the power elite that there is. Keep it simple. Keep it straight. Keep it godly. God doesn't use a hammer on us. God uses the still small voice, the guidance of the Spirit, and the power of the Word. And that's how we change the world.